Hi, everyone. I'm Jennifer Van Alstyne. Welcome to the Social Academic. Today, we're recording the new featured interview. Actually, this is the last featured interview of 2021. So welcome, RJ Thompson. Could you start us out by introducing yourself?
Yeah, sure. And hey, thanks, Jen, for having me. This is really great. And I'm so glad you saved the best for last. Yeah, my name is RJ Thompson. I am the Director of Digital Marketing for the Joseph M. Katz Graduate School of Business at the University of Pittsburgh. And on top of that, I do a number of other things. I do market research, I do graphic design, I teach graphic design at Point Park University and the Community College of Allegheny County. And starting next semester, I'll be teaching in the business school at Pitt. Teaching advertising. So I'm kind of all over the place. And
that's awesome.
You know, if you're listening or paying attention, you might have seen me through the HigherEd Social group and the Marcom group by HigherEd Social. So I'm everywhere.
That's exactly why I wanted to invite you on the show and why I wanted to feature your interview, especially because so many professors, grad students, researchers that are connected with universities out there don't really know what the marketing communications teams at universities do. You're someone who is on both sides of the aisle. So could you tell me a little bit about what you do?
Yeah, you know, to your point, it is an unusual divide. Especially like between design and marketing professors and design and marketing teams. There, for as many similarities as there are, there's many differences. So, but on the staff side, primarily what we do is we're a marketing and communications department. So part of our work includes promoting our programs, promoting the business college and its programs, to prospective students. So there's an enrollment piece to that. There's also a heavy public relations component to that where we're trying to promote the goodwill and works that we're doing to not just the local, but the greater regional, national, and global communities. And also along with that, on the communication side, we're doing a lot of internal marketing and communications to our students, to the broader university, University of Pittsburgh. And we're just doing, it's all inclusive. So if you need an admissions campaign, we're gonna work with the admissions team to produce that. If it's for social media, we're gonna develop out that social strategy plan, but also the ad spend strategy and execution. If we're putting together a magazine, alumni magazine, we'll work with philanthropic and alumni engagement to produce that. So we are at the center of all of these deliverables and we collaborate with the different corresponding units to help them get their messaging out and ultimately create value for the students and alumni. And that value manifests as primarily as brand reinforcement, brand management, brand reinforcement, making sure that the reputation of their degree not only maintains but exceeds and grows. So that's really what we do. And myself as the director of digital marketing, I am responsible for designing and maintaining our web properties, be it our primary website, our microsite, PPC campaigns. I have responsibility to our social media and also our digital advertising. And then all, if it's digital, I own it.
So it sounds like you're working with a lot of different teams. You're working with people across the university and with your own team in order to share good things about the university, about the students, about the alumni, about what you're doing with the community. And it really takes that kind of all-encompassing approach to really communicate the amazing things that universities can do. Now, it's really interesting that you're able to do that and also teach, and you have this real passion for teaching and, you know, really helping students get to the next place in their careers. So can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Sure. So the first part of my career, I've spent 13 years on the faculty side. I've taught at so many different institutions. The last one that I was at, Youngstown State, I was there for 7 years. I was tenured faculty. And make a long story short, the commute from Pittsburgh to Youngstown, it's about an hour each way, was really starting to wear down my body. I missed a lot of time with my daughter who's six. So a decent amount of her infancy I missed. And, you know, one of the things that Youngstown is experiencing now is significant brain drain and enrollment decline. And, you know, you could, if you look at the data, you could kind of sort of see that coming. So mm-hmm. I got out about in the summer of 2019 is when I left the university. And HigherEd is my life. It's where I belong. It's where I fit. I never want to leave this industry. I always want to be on the teaching side. I'm loving the staff side. But unfortunately, when I decided to transition out of YSU, there weren't any full-time tenure track positions available in Pittsburgh. So I decided to try something new and pursue the staff route. And it's been amazing, actually. Mm. And it lets me do both things. So I get the salary I want with a good work-life balance, but that as a part of that balance, it also gives me the time to do a lot of side teaching, freelance, extracurricular stuff. And, you know, I made this remark to my wife the other day. I've never felt so liberated.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
So, when you're on the faculty side, especially when you're chasing tenure and promotion, mm-hmm. you are always doing some kind of peer-reviewed research, peer-reviewed projects that help you build your reputation, build your bona fides. Those are typically passion projects you don't necessarily get paid for, and they take an extreme amount of time investment. And I felt like I hit a peak at YSU, and that's when I switched gears. And when I became staff side, I started taking on more practical work, freelance stuff. I started doing more professional development and certifications. I read a book. Let me be very clear. You would think that is like, why is that at such an important point? Some faculty don't have time to read. I never did. I never had time to actually sit down and read a book, be it fiction or nonfiction. So I have time for that now. And, you know, all the other crazy things that I do that you would see on LinkedIn, getting involved in HigherEd social, starting the competitions, painting a mural, being a poll worker. Like, I'm just checking off the bucket list stuff. And by the way, you're absolutely allowed to criticize me for having poll worker on my bucket list. But
no, I think that's so exciting. And yesterday cool, must actually. Have been a good day for you. I think
it was a long
day for sure. Yeah. You know, you've done so many things, and I just am so glad that you came on this show to talk about it, because, you know, even though you're talking about how much time that took, you're still teaching, you know, you're still doing this and keeping this as part of your life. You're working with faculty, you're working with graduate students to tell their stories through some of the marketing work that you do. I mean, you really are able to do it all. So when you talk about liberation, when you talk about the freedom that this job gives you, it sounds like one of the things that you love most is being able to work on all of those things. Whereas before, maybe your focus would only have been able to be research as like the main priority.
Yeah. You know, when it comes to liberation, it wasn't just the ability to do new things and different things, but mm-hmm. it was also the ability to explore my creativity in an area that mattered, in something that mattered a lot. I've become disillusioned with freelance work over the past number of years, and a lot of it has to do with clients that I call the low-hanging fruit. Which are typically the clients that want the world on a shoestring budget with a deadline of yesterday. Mm-hmm. And that's really stressful for a design faculty person chasing tenure and promotion. And so I just decided to put that stuff away. And when I came to the business school at Pitt, you know, they've got such a great marketing team, but they always had limited capacity to really just rip the lid off of it, go for broke, and do some really strategic and creative things. And they just let me go. And that resulted in a profound amount of accolades. Like I was, you know, not to brag, but just to illustrate the point, the websites I designed for the business school, back-to-back award winner in the Best of American Web Design by GDUSA, which wow. is one of the top, thank you, one of the top periodicals for the design industry. Being able to meet folks like you and speak at conferences and help Higher Ed Social build their foundation, it's just exciting.
Wow. I, you know, bragging is one thing that I actually wanted to talk with you about, because when we first met, you had invited me onto your podcast, and you had mentioned that awards were something that were important to you, not only important for you, but important to put your team up for, to encourage other people to apply for awards. And I love celebrating with you. I see your news on social media, on Facebook, on Twitter. And it's exciting when something good happens to people. I enjoy seeing that. And so I love cheering you on. Can you tell me more about like that? Tell me more about looking for awards and why that's important to you.
Yeah. So this is layered. So the first part is I've been a designer for 25 years. I'm 36. I've been doing this since I was a kid. And graphic designers tend to be very competitive people. They need to be, because they're competing against each other for jobs in industry, and industry typically tends to choose the most talented people. So I'm fortunate in that I've been a designer my entire life, and I know all facets of it. I don't claim to be a master of any of them, but you know, you need me to animate something, I can do that. You need to do some video, I can do that. So I do have a jack of all trades vibe. And so being able to work in the different aspects of design and compete with others is exciting to me. And what I get out of that is, it's not necessarily a satisfaction. It's like a justification. It's more like, hey, you know, you said you could do it and you did it. And you put all of the work in to get to that point. So the Pitt Business website, when I redesigned it, it took 13 months. That's all I did every day. And it was a real labor of love. And I was proud of the work, but it's also important to me that when you do a project like that, you don't ever do it alone. And to reinforce the point that you made about getting people to submit their work, I made sure that my entire marketing team had their names on that project. And my marketing team, save for my designer colleague, their early career. So that's important to like get them those accolades, because that's the foundation for the rest of their career. Mm. I would not have been able to get where I am and doing what I'm doing had I not pursued design competitively, because those accolades got me my next job and my next job and opened up so many opportunities. It opened up teaching to me, frankly. I won an award for a book I made. A faculty person happened to see it and they're like, you should teach. And 4 months later, I got a teaching job. So it's kind of proof positive. So there's the benefits you get from asserting yourself and putting yourself out there as a competitive person, a high performance kind of person. And I think that is attractive to a lot of different people. And then the third part is I'm a person with an invisible disability. I have a genetic disease called cystic fibrosis. And had you met me when I was a kid, I was scrawny and frail and sickly. And over the years, I've gotten better. And now I'm on gene therapy and my symptoms are gone. So I've made amazing, great strides in my self-care. But I had a doctor tell me once, like, you're not gonna live to see 40. And I'm 36. Now, what that doctor doesn't know is that I'm actually immortal and I'll never die. But what that did was that motivated me to shoot for as far and as wide and as fast as towards my goals as I could. I mean, in high school, I was a moderate student, average, you know, but when I got to college, I made it a point to like be A's across the board. And I knew that grades would not necessarily matter when I entered the industry. It was more about personal pride and the stakes that I put into performing. So yeah, I put all of my effort, all of myself into my work, even at the college level. I got awards there that led on to internships at agencies and the like. And it's been a beneficial thing for me. At the end of my career, I want to be able to say, I didn't get to everything I wanted to, but the things that I did get to, I did really well at.
I love that.
And then I can wipe my hands of it and put it away and go build a birdhouse or something. Whatever retired people do. I don't think I'll retire ever. Even if, you know, once a designer, always a designer, I'll still be making something.
And you do work at making different things. I know that like in the last year, along with doing all of that design work that you've been doing for the marketing team, along with teaching, you also created Comm Centered, which is this massive archive of branding and all sorts of stuff for higher ed marketers. Tell me a little bit about that.
So Comm Centered is an interesting little story that started with another inventory that I built. So one of the things that I like to do is I like to understand systems comprehensively, holistically, and I like looking at trends and commonalities. So one of the things that myself and one of my colleagues, whom is a retired computer science professor, one of the things that we did was we did an inventory of all of the logos of municipalities in America with populations of 10,000 or above.
Wow.
And we collected thousands of logos, thousands. And I put them into an archive and I was able to look at everything and say like, wow, when you look at the 4,000 logos or whatever it is that we found, half of them have a specifically designed brand concept. And then the others are municipal seals. So when you start to really narrow the focus and understand why half was the way that it was and the other half, et cetera, you learn that it came down to a lot of like complex things like elected leadership, municipal governance, laws, how communities were financed. And that was an informative lesson for me because the company I run is called Plus Public. And part of our work is in branding communities. So I wanted to understand why some of these communities don't have good marketing. And that inventory was very informative with respect to that. So Comm Centered was a response to what was going on in Higher Ed Social. So Higher Ed Social is a Facebook group about 9,500 members strong all across the world, higher ed marketers, higher ed designers, social media marketers. And the sense that I was getting was that a lot of these folks did not have a great swell of pride in their work. Even in the little tiny corners of the world that they work, they may not have had a lot of pride in their work because their messaging is very highly overseen. Their protocols for how to communicate with people. And in some cases, especially on the social media side, it's kind of a thankless job. And I want to celebrate those people. I want to celebrate the work that they're doing, how they're doing it, why they're doing it. The concept of having to advertise education is fascinating to me. This is an act that people learn something new every day, whether or not they are trying. That's just a part of the human experience. So the fact that we have to advertise it is just really compelling to me. So taking that concept and then also wanting to be the biggest cheerleader for these people and celebrate their work led to Calm Centered. And when you layer in that brand's inventory for the community brand's inventory, I basically did a study where we took all of the institutions, higher ed institutions in every state, and we looked at the commonalities. And every state has their own set of trends that some correlate to others, some do not. And it's been really, really informative. So right now I'm finishing my series of 50 posts on the brands of higher ed, just for the United States. And I have plans on expanding that globally.
That is so exciting. You know, when you told me that this project had suddenly been created, I was shocked, because last time we had spoken, you had said that you were going to be updating your personal website. We'd actually chatted about it and we had this plan. And then all of a sudden there was this massive archive, this big website that really can help people around the world understand more about higher ed marketing, that can really celebrate their work in a way that the public can see, that each other can see. It was astounding that you'd created this massive project. And you're also working on these other things, right? You have your job, you have your teaching, and here you are creating this nonprofit, you know, project. And I was just so amazed by you. I think my heart grows bigger every time I talk to you, because you're so generous with what you give to the world.
You know, well, thank you for that. And, you know, there was one lesson I learned a long time ago is that nothing happens until someone gets excited. And leave it to, you know, an advertising guy to say that, but it's absolutely true. And I believe that wholeheartedly. If it takes me, if whatever effort I put into something, I hope that it excites people double the effort that I put in. And fortunately, I kind of have a knack for choosing the right things. Sometimes I don't, but for the most part, I do. And it's always exciting to build community around common threads. And, you know, the thing with higher ed, people in higher ed, I think most of them would stay, and talent would be retained at a higher frequency, at a higher rate, if certain conditions were met relative to just the daily working life and the process and the experience of those types of jobs. And with Calm Centered, it was really important to me to not only be a contrast to some of the other higher ed marketers that you'll see out there, and I'll elaborate on that in a moment, but I didn't want to tell people how the work was done. They know how the work is done. I want to show them what work was done. And the thinking here is a picture's worth a thousand words. If you see one logo, or if you see one ad campaign, that's going to kick off a spiral of new ideas for the people that are looking at it. So, and I also have an additional point to that I think is apropos. So, the one point I wanted to make was on Twitter, on social media, even in the higher ed social groups, there are a ton of people that assert themselves as higher ed marketing thought leaders, as, you know, I'll use the term know-it-alls as positively as possible. There are a lot of authors that assert their knowledge and wisdom, and it's valuable. But it consistently skews more towards, here's the roadmap, here's the foundation, here are some of the strategies, and that's where it ends. Okay, well, thank you. I loved reading your 400-page book. The strategies and the roadmaps are great, but what have people done with it? I want to see what people have done with it. Calm Centered, I want to feature the work that people are creating so that they can understand the context or the outputs of those roadmaps and get inspired on their own. So the last part to this is I love voice actors. This is a really unique hobby of mine. So I watch cartoons with my daughter, and I'm able to pick out, you know, oh, that's Rob Paulson. Oh, I know who did that.
Recognize them.
I can recognize the voices, even if they are doing a completely different voice. And if you listen to some of the podcasts from voice actors, they love their job so much because all they do is play. And playing to them is doing a bad impression of someone else. And so it's additive. So for example, if I did, and I won't do any impressions, I won't embarrass myself to that degree, but if I did an impression of Christopher Walken, right? And it was terrible. That's okay, because I've just created a new character, something completely original. So I can intentionally do something bad and create something really good and funny out of it. And that was one of the other inspirations behind doing the archive, the logo inventory, featuring, doing assessments on social media ads and all of that stuff. So when I look at your work or someone else's work, I judge it. And I'm like, damn, that's a good idea. I really like that. How can I take that idea? If it's a box, how can I push one side in and rotate it and make it my own, right? It needs to be malleable. So, and you know, the last part to that is that concept, that theme is absolutely part and parcel to who I am as a person and how I teach creativity. So that's kind of the overarching through line of my entire life and career and teaching career too.
You teach creativity. I really like that. Now, I have a question about that, and I didn't send this to you in advance or anything, but a lot of professors, a lot of graduate students, doesn't matter what field they're in, don't believe they have creativity. But you talk about creativity as something that can be taught. I think that a lot of those people who feel like they don't have creativity actually do, and maybe they don't necessarily recognize it in themselves. But what do you think about that?
So there's kind of an anecdote or a adage that I share with my students. And that is, one, I can teach you all the software in the world, but if you can't think creatively, then all of that knowledge is not really useful. You're solving problems that are very finite and technical and, dare I say, just kind of binary, yes or no. One way or the other. Creativity is something that can be, you can be born just with this incredible intrinsic creativity, but you have deficits in other areas, right? So I relay a story to them where I've always been an ambitious creative person, even when I was like a five-year-old. When I was four or five, I opened up my parents' typewriter. And I made stories and I henpecked at the keyboard. And then I moved on to a neighborhood newspaper, 5-6 years old doing this,
wow.
Right? Who does that? And I'm sure it does happen. And I'm not saying that I'm special by any means, but it's at least indicative of how my creativity manifested organically, naturally. Mm-hmm. There are some people that feel that they are not creative at all. And to them, I say, you are creative, but you are maybe a different aspect or facet of creativity. But for the most part, the problem is that people don't understand the steps in which to be creative. So one of the things that I teach them is how to solve problems using a creative inquiry. And that's essentially also an aspect of design thinking. So, you know, I had mentioned the project, I didn't tell you what it was that kicked off my teaching career. And it was a book called Thompson Design Methodologies. And it was all about solving problems visually. So how do I, and this is something I deal with my clients, you know, if I'm making a logo for you, Jen, what's one word that you would want your clientele to associate you with? Let's say it's integrity. Mm-hmm. What does integrity look like as a box or a shape rather? Is it a rectangle? Is it a triangle? Is the triangle proportional or is it skewed? If you had to hold it in your hand, how heavy would it be? What's the texture? Like asking really abstract questions to fire up the creative parts of their brain and purposely getting them to zag instead of zig. So if you're always zigging on something, right, you're always making the same type of choice. If I put you in a box and make you do something different, that is forcing creativity on you because you don't know what comes next. And then as you branch out from there, every decision you make is based on an unknown output. So it's a lot about challenging conventions, challenging your comfort zones. I talk a lot about fear and the boxes of fear and complacency and all that stuff. And once people start to really understand why they are in the box and they can't get out of the box, once they start to understand that, they realize that this isn't like some tried and true foundation for making creativity happen. It's more of an understanding and recognition of their own hesitancies and character flaws that they perceive that they have to work out of. So it's more psychological about them as a person. And then once you kind of overcome some of those things, solving problems isn't hard. It's fun. And if you know how to solve those problems, you have a step process, then you and your process is built with error and experimentation built into it, then your work becomes more fun. But the best thing of all is that your work becomes more informed and it's of a higher quality. So much so that you start solving problems unlike anybody else. So when your employer sees how deeply and immersively you understand a problem and how you use that deep immersion to create a unique and amazing and equally immersive solution, they don't want to lose you. I could go on and on, but it's absolutely true. So it's one of my favorite things about teaching and, you know, seeing people really break out of the box and rise above and into their careers and meeting their self-concept, this idea of the idealized self-concept. Who are you in your most ideal sense? If you can use these design methodologies, these creative problem solving tactics, you can get closer and closer to that thing. So if your dream for your career has always been to be a director of digital marketing, and then when you get there, it's like, oh, wow, I was able to get there using these tactics and techniques. What do I do next? Some people may not have envisioned the next thing beyond that ultimate thing. So it's liberating in that respect too.
One of the things that you brought up while you were just talking was fear and anxiety. And it actually reminded me that I wanted to ask you about that as it relates to awards that you've won. A lot of the professors that I work with and people who are in my courses feel really anxious when talking about their awards on social media, especially sharing it with their department, even internally. There's a lot of anxiety when it comes to that. Have you ever experienced any backlash for sharing your awards?
As a matter of fact, yes. It's what led me to leave my tenured teaching position. It's unfortunate that it worked out the way that it did. One of the things that I dealt with specifically was I put all of myself into my work and I believe in my work wholeheartedly. And when you put me into a position where you basically say, hey, in order to get tenure and promotion, you have to have peer-reviewed evaluations of your work. Part of that are competitions, juried exhibitions. That's part of the game. That is the game. And I made it a point to put all of my effort into playing that game well. And I did, and so much so that I received one of Ohio's highest honors in art. I received an art award from the governor, and I got to meet him and his wife and everything. And what that did was the community that I was in, they celebrated that work because the thing that I made that got me that award was ultimately for the Youngstown region. It celebrated them. But right. on the faculty level, all that did was breed jealousy and resentment, and inferiority complexes shot through the roof. And because I was junior faculty, that was used against me. Mm-hmm. And instead of seeing that as an opportunity to build into my energy, collaborate, let's share our successes together. Instead, what happened was that some of my peer faculty grew resentful. They grew jealous. They used tactics to essentially punish me. They made sure that my tenure process was hell. Mm-hmm. And on paper, I was very tenurable. So that's one of the reasons why I got it. But I know that the spirit of celebrating your peers was not there. And a lot of that came back to graphic design was a popular major. And the professors that were jealous and resentful of me were not in graphic design. And more importantly, they didn't understand the forest for the trees. And I was responsible for bringing a lot of new students to the design program and also those fine art programs. And I realized that, you know, that summer of 19, like, I didn't want to leave tenure. I fought so hard for it, but no amount of tenure or promotion was going to be worth the mental stress and anxiety that they would place on me just by virtue of wanting to do my job really well. And
especially when it's for, in this specific instance, this is for the community. This is something that you were doing for the town of Youngstown. And it just,
well, yeah, they basically said I was trying to be a showboat and I was being obnoxious with I'm a marketer. I understand how branding works. I understand how marketing works. If I'm going to put all of my effort into something, I want to make sure that people know about it. There's nothing wrong with that. And, you know, frankly, for some of the folks that are concerned about, you know, if they're too timid to promote themselves and their work, I completely get that because of what I went through. And I say to hell with them. Rise above it. If you submit your work to a competition and you get acknowledged, the people in your life, if they're worth keeping around, they will celebrate your efforts. They will support you. They will champion you. And you will do the same for them in return. If they don't do that for you, then you need to consider your place in that community. Do I want you to leave that community? Absolutely not. But there, it is much harder to leave a situation, or it's easier to leave a situation than it is to change an entire community of people that ultimately don't want you to be successful. They want the successes that you captured for themselves. And no one wants to be around folks like that. No one grows when resentment breeds eternal like that. Hmm. So I say, you know, if you believe in your work, you put yourself into it completely and you have some money to spare to put it into a competition or any peer-reviewed situation like that, do it. Because the benefits you get from it will hopefully far exceed the criticism that you get. So to give you an example, when I did that work for Youngstown and got the award from the Ohio governor, I had a number of communities knocking on my door saying, we want you to replicate that work here. We'll pay you market value for what you do. We'll defer to your expertise. We just want good work and you're a proven commodity. Okay, let's do it. And so we did. And, you know, in the case of, just to switch gears real quick, in the case of Pitt Business, it was really important to me that I was given so much freedom and latitude to essentially do what I felt was best from a marketing perspective, from a design perspective. I was able to completely reboot all of our marketing collateral. I didn't do it alone. And I wanted people to know in my college that my marketing team, the one I'm on, is the best. We're the best ones for the job. But I also wanted to tell all the 300 some odd marketers at the University of Pittsburgh that we're the best marketing team on campus.
Ooh.
Right? And we did it 2 years in a row. And when we do that, we say, yeah, we believe in our work enough to do this. Let us help you. We will do this because we're colleagues, because we want to see you succeed as well. So you build a spirit of camaraderie in this community, and, you know, rising tide lifts all ships. So there's, you know, the ultimate goal would be, hey, my marketing team gives some advice to all the different colleges at Pitt, and, you know, maybe they come out with some better looking work and they see increased enrollment and everybody prospers. So that's kind of the intent. And let me just say that, you know, for my supervisors, for my marketing team, they like the acknowledgement. It makes them feel good. It builds confidence in their work, and it energizes them to do more ambitious work or more involved work. It's not just going through the motions anymore. We're building something. And it's that paradigm shift that has caused a lot of our success and just good feelings about our jobs.
Oh, thanks for sharing that. Now, I wanted to ask for the professors and researchers out there, what are some ways in which you as a marketing department have collaborated with them to tell their stories? Can you share an example?
I would say first off, and I know many higher ed marketers can relate to this. There's a perception, and a well-founded perception, that faculty generally are too busy to participate in marketing efforts. And to an extent, that is true. And there's nothing wrong with that because they're doing their jobs, right? We only have so many hours in the day. Part of our goal is we want to celebrate our faculty as much as we celebrate the outcomes and career goals of our students. And fortunately, we have very proactive, productive faculty that are doing world-changing work. And they understand the value of marketing that, and they work with us to do that. But it doesn't mean it's easy. Mm-hmm. It's not often easy to work with your faculty to get what you need from them. And we've basically, I won't give you a specific test case, but what I can say is, if you're a faculty member and you open yourself up to being promoted, the work that you're doing, you want it to be signal boosted, because that builds your reputation in your community, amongst the faculty, amongst the greater faculty, amongst the student body, right? Be open to letting us help you signal boost your work. We can do some amazing and creative things if you just give us the time of day. You know, give us a couple hours every week and we will work our asses off for you. It's reciprocal, and it's a reciprocal respect and understanding that in order for collaboration to be successful for all stakeholders and all beneficiaries, you got to put the time in. And we have a lot of faculty that are writing books. We just won an $800,000 grant. One of our marketing faculty won this massive grant. And, you know, we want to put that out into the world. So let us help you. So if you're a faculty person and you're wondering how to get promoted, work with us. Respect our work. Respect our capabilities. You don't have to do it alone. We champion our entire community. I think that is the best way to do it. And, you know, don't be afraid to shout your accolades from the roof. It's okay. Our students want professors that are doing amazing work. When I was tenure track, and even still to this day on the faculty side, I always show real world practical work that I'm doing because it contextualizes the professional experience for my students. Oh, wow, he's still doing something. That's awesome. I can learn from him because he's still in play. And it's not like, oh, my professor's 70 years old and he hasn't designed anything in 20 years. That's not the case at all. So let us in, we'll tell your story, and that will create ripple effects all through our marketing. And, you know, there's also another basic sort of formula here. The more you help us promote you, the better the students you'll get. Ooh. Every faculty person wants better students, every single one, because it makes the teaching experience more enriching for them and for us. We don't necessarily like having to go through the lecture, here's the homework assignment, go on your merry way. We don't want to go through the motions if we don't have to. We have a profound amount of knowledge to share. If we have better students, they're going to be more engaged and more interested in learning those little details, those anecdotes from practice or whatever. And it makes faculty feel good about their job and about the work that they do. So I think that is an operative sort of thing to think about. And also consider the opposite. You don't participate, you ignore us. That makes our lives a lot more difficult because we've got to track you down. And if you don't respond to us, then we have to talk to the chair or the dean, then the dean and the chair come down on you. No faculty person really ever wants to talk to their chair or dean. I kid. But it's true, like it doesn't have to come to that. So just work with us and we will do what we can, 100%.
I think that's such an important sentiment. It's going to take work on both sides, right? You guys have so much expertise you're hoping to share with the faculty who want to promote themselves and promote their research. I think that's wonderful. But it sounds like maybe faculty really don't know what to expect. They don't know what the potential is for themselves. So yeah. There are ways for you to celebrate them, but the faculty need to be more open about it in order for you to even be aware of each other, it sounds like.
So on that note, one tactic that I've taken recently is I've added all 125 of our faculty to LinkedIn. Mm-hmm. And I track their profiles because they're more prone to update their LinkedIn and self-promote versus telling us. So as soon as I see something, it's going over here. And then I just traffic control the content. And, you know, that actually brings in another point where, hey, faculty, we want to work with you as much as possible, but guess what? We want to make the process as easy for you as possible. So if we need you to record a video, we're going to script the whole thing, put it on a teleprompter. You come in, spend 10 minutes with us, read it, and you're out. Right?
I love that.
Because they have to go teach their classes, and depending on your institution, at mine, rankings are extremely important. We need our faculty in the classroom teaching our students well so our rankings go up, so our student body becomes more enriched and we pull in better prospects and everybody wins.
So if faculty are more open about their accomplishments with their marketing teams and more willing to put in some effort in order to help those marketing teams promote their work, then it can make a big difference for everyone. The faculty can get better students, the student body can hear more awesome news about their faculty, and it can really reach a larger audience. I see lots of higher ed posts about professors, about scientists and researchers being shared with much wider audiences than just the community. It can reach people around the world. So this is great.
And you know, the next step to that is they see the results and then they decide to be proactive and really participate. All right, let's get, if I could have 125 different Twitter accounts for every single faculty member and they were off and running and doing really well with it, awesome. Oh my God, the marketing ecosystem that I would be working with would be profound and huge. And yeah, it'd probably be stressful as hell. But we would have 125 of our biggest advocates out there in the world telling other people how good our programs are, you know, and that's good branding. But, you know, they're researchers. They, by virtue of the description of their positions, they've got to be researching, they've got to be teaching and writing grants, and that's what they do. So, you know, maybe we'll get there someday.
Well, if you're a professor, if you're a researcher who's watching this, you know, go check out my blog, The Social Academic, at theacademicdesigner.com/blog. There are tons of resources for joining Twitter, joining other social media platforms. Definitely doesn't have to take all of your time, just a little bit of practice talking about yourself, maybe talking about your research and sharing it publicly is going to make a big difference for you. So I do encourage you to check out The Social Academic blog. RJ, I'm so glad we've had all of these conversations. We've talked about your work as a director of marketing. We've talked about Plus Public, your business. We talked about ComCentered. We talked about what it's like to be a faculty member at the same time. Is there anything else that you'd like to share or chat about before we wrap up?
Cool. You know, I'm all over the place with my interests, but they are mostly higher ed specific. And I walk both on both sides of that higher ed dividing line. And, you know, I'm on the staff side, I'm on the faculty. And it's the best place to be as a marketer because it lets me understand what my audiences want. It's a very organic transition of data and learning. And so, you know, my marketing savvy helps me teach better because it's vocal, it's public speaking, it's presentation of my PowerPoints and other things. And then on the opposite side, I'm learning how to better communicate with my, you know, students, but also prospective students. So they're mutually beneficial. And then with higher ed, with my higher ed research on ComCentered, now I'm getting some of that research on the faculty side that I can apply to the staff side. And, you know, one thing that I've been struggling with that I wanted to share was, and maybe some of the faculty listening can understand that. I often say when the muse speaks, listen. It may not always make sense. It may not always be compatible, but I often have these moments where I've just got the gears are turning in my head. It just randomly clicks on and I just start writing ideas down. So like last Saturday, it was a birthday party for one of my daughter's friends. I was sitting in a Chuck E. Cheese and I'm at a table by myself with a notebook, like a super nerd in, you know, ignoring everyone else. And I'm writing down pages of notes, just things that are firing through my head. And my energy is like, oh my God, this is so awesome. I think I can do this. And then I eventually hit a wall and like, I look at my notes and I'm just thinking like, this has all been done before. Hmm. So if you're out there and like, you feel like you have this energy to like write a book or a series of books or contribute to the knowledge base in a big way, you actually can, and you should. And, you know, don't be afraid of like imposter syndrome or that you feel like everything that has been said or done can be said or done has already been said or done. So one of the things that I did was I reached out to a few people and I said, I've got this energy. I know what I want to say and how to say it, but I don't quite know the format. One person, Alexa Heinrich, our friend in Higher Ed Social, she said, everything that can be said or done in accessibility has been said and done. The difference is her perspective on it.
Right.
And she recognized that up front. And that was, for me, really hard to swallow, to accept. Because I come from this faculty academic side where original thought is highly coveted and valued. Mm-hmm. And I just couldn't quite get there for whatever reason, confidence issues, self-esteem. I just didn't have a good mentor to help me guide through this process. And Alexa just, she nailed it. And so I took that and, you know, I was feeling really down on ComCentered because I hadn't blogged in a while. And then I talked to Amy Jalman, who's the chief education officer for the National Institute for Social Media, who wrote quite literally a book this thick on social media. And I said, how did you get to that point? And she basically said, oh, I just sat down at the computer and started writing. I'm like, screw you. I don't want to hear it. But she gave me some really great advice. And then I started to turn the gears a little bit. And I'm like, okay, calm centered should be what it already is. It's a website. It's active. It's an archive. It's the only inventory of higher ed logos on the internet. I've already checked the boxes, but because of some lack of objectivity or lack of confidence or something, I felt like it wasn't original. And sure enough, it is. And it's one of the reasons why, you know, you and I connected and we keep circling this conversation. So as I'm starting to get my confidence back, and if you're an academic researcher and you hit that lull where you think no one's going to care, this is why you have to stay the course and continue on. Randomly, I got an email from a journalist at the Australian equivalent of the Chronicle or Chronicle of Higher Education or whatever. And he's like, hey, I came across Calm Centered and it is absolutely stunning. No one else, I've never seen anyone do anything like this, period. And all of a sudden my soul left my body and all of the energy that I took from the universe came right back into my body. And I started making more, writing those blog posts. And the other part to his message was, I want to have you speak on these topics at Australia's biggest higher ed conference. And I want to have you be a panelist. I want to learn more about that work. And so we got the ball rolling, right? But that's not where it ends. Where it ends is to present day, where I looked at his website and all of the articles. And I'm thinking, you know, the MarCom sector of higher education is gigantic. There are over 9,000 universities globally. But there's no centralized knowledge base for those people. So now I'm looking at, all right, well, Calm Centered was just a champion for the work. Calm Centered 2.0 can be something else entirely. What that is just yet, I don't know, but it could be big on that scale. So stay the course, researchers. What you're doing absolutely has value.
Thank you so much, RJ. Where can people connect with you or get in touch with you or learn more about you?
So once again, I'm everywhere. So you could go to, you can follow me on Twitter at RJTPITT. That's also my Instagram handle. You can find me on LinkedIn. If you want, you can go to comcentered, comcentered.org and find me there. imrjthompson.com. You can find me there. I'm quite literally everywhere. I'm even on TikTok. Okay. I'm everywhere. So, and you know, you can probably find me, via, Jen's website as well, your website. Yes, so
that's perfect. I'm going to drop those links in the description. So do reach out and connect with RJ. I have loved this conversation. Can't wait to write up the blog post for this. So if you're watching us live or if you're catching this video before the blog post is up, do check out the academicdesigner.com/blog because this featured interview will be coming soon. Thank you so much for joining me today. RJ, stick around for a sec.
Sounds good. Thank you.
I'm just waiting for the stream to end on YouTube. It's like a slight delay.
That's good. Yeah. Well, thanks for that. That was awesome. Very cathartic for me. I haven't had a lot of opportunity to share some of those thoughts with people.
You really, let me catch it now. Sorry. You really opened up and I was